This episode is brought to you by Brilliant. Wind power is one of the fastest growing renewable sources in the world that works well at scale, but it's not perfect. A wind turbine's massive size and moving parts make them challenging to roll out because of the space they take up, as well as the maintenance. But what if we could scale down that power to something that could fit on your roof and be self-contained with smaller moving parts, or maybe no blades or moving parts at all? Let's look at some of the future alternatives for harnessing wind power. I'm Matt Farrell. Welcome to Undecided. It's not hard to see that along with solar, wind power has been a major player all over the world in lowering our carbon emissions from fossil fuels. According to the latest global wind report, 93 gigawatts of new global wind power capacity was installed in 2020, with the US and China leading the way. And currently, 743 gigawatts of wind power capacity is installed worldwide, making it the green power source with the most decarbonization potential per megawatt. It's helping to avoid over 1.1 billion tons of CO2 globally. But wind turbines aren't all good. As I mentioned in a previous video, wind turbines have several downsides. Harnessing wind requires high upfront costs, and the energy generation isn't effective for individual homes or small-scale installations as they are at large scale. The construction of wind farms has also had an impact on wildlife. And while they do kill a good number of birds and bats every year, when you look at those numbers in context, it's blown a little bit out of proportion. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service estimates that between 140,000 and 500,000 birds die at wind farms each year. Now compare that to 2.4 billion birds that are killed in the U.S. each year by domesticated cats, or the 1 billion birds that die from flying into windows. And there's some simple solutions for wind turbines that are proving effective, like just painting one of the blades black. It's helping to protect the birds. But there's also the fact that turbines have a lot of moving parts, like the gearbox, which requires a decent amount of maintenance. They need to be checked 2 to 3 times a year, and this is where solid-state wind power arrives on the scene. In 2013, researchers at Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands removed the need for moving mechanical components and created EWECON, I think that's how you say that acronym, which stands for Electrostatic Wind Energy Converter, kicking off the development of the ion wind generator concept. Now, while it's still very much in development, it provides significantly lower maintenance costs, less wear and tear, and no noise issues. And how it works is kind of fascinating. EWECON utilizes wind to create a flow of charged particles through the air that can be tapped into to produce electricity. In this case, water droplets are used to hold a positive charge, and when the wind blows through them, this movement of the droplets produces electricity that can be transferred to the grid. A prototype of EWECON is installed at Delft University of Technology, but I couldn't find any information if it's still actually running or not. Now, an obvious downside of this idea is the reliance on water to carry the charge. You need a water line run to the installations, and it wouldn't work in freezing temperatures. But there's another idea called the solid-state wind energy transformer, with the unfortunate acronym SWET. It's developed by Richard Epstein. His approach is very similar to what the Dutch developed, but instead of using water, his concept uses ionic currents to produce electricity. This process is called electrohydrodynamics. Richard Epstein described the prototype as a series of 55 parallel aluminum wires strung between two 8.5 meter tall wooden masts, separated by about 8 meters on a flat roof, and all the wires were electrically isolated from the masts. In the prototype, there were two kinds of wires, attractor wires, which were the plain wires, and emitter wires that contained small tufts of 7 micrometer diameter carbon fibers attached about every 15 centimeters. When small negative currents flow through the emitter wires, the tufts create a coronal discharge, releasing negative ions into the air. It's not that different from the ionic air purifiers that were all the rage in the early 2000s, if you remember the ionic breeze. I'm still trying to forget those commercials. So just like the EWECON concept, the wind blowing past the wires carries the negative ions with it, and the array gets a slight positive charge. This causes electrons to flow from the ground, which can be collected as electricity. The prototype developed by Epstein has just 1/20th of a watt of power. It's not that much. But it's just a prototype to prove the concept, and it's still in the first steps of development. Now, utilizing the same principles of EWECON, the Dutch Windwheel Corporation is developing a 160 to 180 meter tall building that is going to be a landmark of Rotterdam. It looks kind of like a gigantic donut. The hole in the center will be putting this solid-state energy generation to work. The structure is also intended to pull together multiple eco-friendly technologies like rainwater capture, wetland water filtration, and solar energy. Not to mention apartments, a hotel, and a skybar. Who doesn't love a good skybar? Well, it's expected to be built sometime between 2022 and 2025. Now, as cool as that tech is, it's still very much in the early phases of development. But there's some other technologies that could be hitting the residential and city market sooner. Another type of wind generator without moving parts has been developed by Vortex Bladeless. But warning, it looks a little weird. This Spanish company has developed a vortex-induced vibration-resonant wind generator, which is based on the principle of vortex shedding. The generator is built with the shape of a cylinder, producing electricity through the alternator system when the mast oscillates. The bottom of the rod is firmly attached to the ground, but the upper portion is unconstrained and able to vibrate. The structure is built with materials used in traditional wind turbine blades, which is resins reinforced with carbon or glass fiber. But Bladeless wind turbines get rid of the mechanical elements that can suffer wear by friction. But how does this wiggling, vibrating column produce energy? Well, to understand this, we need to jump a little bit back into the world of fluid mechanics. As wind passes by a blunt body, the flow is changed, producing a cyclical vortices pattern known as vortex shedding. Now imagine placing a cylinder partially submerged into running water. If the water is moving too fast or too slow, the vortices that form around the cylinder are chaotic. But if the speed of the water and the frequency of the object are matched, the vortices form more consistently and will exert force on the cylinder, causing it to move. Every body or structure has a natural frequency. If the frequency of these vortices is close enough to the body's structural frequency, it starts to oscillate, resonating with the wind. This is also known as vortex-induced vibration. You've probably seen or heard of the ramifications of this effect on bridges that weren't designed properly, like the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. Engineers and architects design bridges and skyscrapers to avoid this effect. They design structures to have different resonant frequencies from the wind's resonant frequency. But Vortex Bladeless is doing the exact opposite in order to put vortex-induced vibration to work. Vortex's mass geometry is specifically designed to achieve maximum performance with typical wind speeds. To convert these vibrations into electricity, Vortex Bladeless turbines utilize an alternator system made by coils and magnets. They can adapt the vortex dynamics with no gears, shafts, or rotating parts. This design provides reduced maintenance and rules out the need for greasing. Now, this magnetic confinement design acts as a tuning system, so it can increase the stiffness of the system according to the deformation that the wind causes. It's basically adjusting and synchronizing its natural frequency to match the wind's frequency. If you compare turbines of similar sizes, a Vortex Bladeless turbine harvests about 30% of the area that's covered by a three-bladed wind turbine design. This is called swept area. The bottom line, Vortex technology is less power efficient than traditional three-bladed turbines, since the power production is proportional to the swept area of the turbine. On the flip side, a smaller swept area also means more bladeless turbines can be placed in the same area, making up for that efficiency gap. Now, running at low to medium wind speeds, it's able to generate the same power for less cost. It's about 45% cheaper than a traditional three-bladed design. The Vortex Tacoma model, which is 2.7 meters high, has an estimated power output of 100 watts, and the company expects the Vortex Tacoma models to have similar prices to medium-high production solar panels. Now, getting closer to the residential market for wind turbines, Savonius turbines have been gaining in popularity. These wind turbines are simple, drag-type devices that consist of two or three scoops. Due to their curvature, the scoops experience less drag when moving against the wind than moving with it, which makes it extract less wind power than other lift-type turbines of a similar size. However, they are very cost-effective and can operate regardless of the wind direction. The blades in the turbine have no mechanism to alter the angles, and they're more bird and bat friendly than conventional three-bladed turbines. Now, with that in mind, the Iceland-based company Icewind has been manufacturing Savonius turbines for residential and commercial applications. Their CW100 model, which is sold as the Freya here in the US, is designed to deliver long-lasting performance with little or no maintenance for over 25 years. This 1.5 meter high turbine is able to withstand speeds up to 130 miles per hour, or about 60 meters per second, and generate up to 600 watts. The company sells each turbine for $3,200 and a complete on-grid system with a 1.5 kilowatt inverter for $4,180. Now in the US, the cost of a set of solar panels to produce the same 600 watts would be around $1,900. The turbine is a bit more expensive, but you also get the potential for producing power during the night. But the innovations on wind power don't stop there. Helsium is a startup based in Salt Lake City, Utah, and is hoping its portable wind turbine will be the next big innovation in green energy. The company's been developing what they call a Powerpod, which is a small-scale wind turbine designed specifically to work in towns and cities. The Powerpod does have a blade system, but it's completely contained within the shell, making it safe for kids, pets, and wildlife since it has no external moving parts. The wind generator shape can collect wind from any direction, changing directions, or even multiple directions at once. A 1 kilowatt wind turbine could produce up to 3 times more power than a normally mounted turbine of a similar size and swept area. This extra power comes from the advanced blade system of the pod, which boosts the wind speed by 40%. To make this happen, the power pod takes air and funnels it into a smaller exit, which speeds it up before hitting the internal blades. In a way, it kind of reminds me a little bit of the Dyson vacuum cleaner's Vortex Cyclone. Now, much like some of the other turbines I've talked about, the interesting angle with the PowerPod is its capability of being either connected to a building on its own or paired with solar to diversify your power sources. And the PowerPod's design means it can be installed anywhere: house rooftops, public buildings, fences, you name it. Nick Hodges, the founder of Halcyon, created a map showing the average daily power generated from a 1 kilowatt PowerPod compared to a 1 kilowatt solar panel system in different parts of the world. In most cities, the PowerPod could perform equal or greater than a conventional 1 kilowatt solar panel system. A big reason for this is the 24/7 operation, while solar is limited to daylight hours and has lower production on cloudy or rainy days. Although the PowerPod isn't for sale quite yet, and the specifications aren't well known, it's an interesting idea to bring wind generation in a more flexible package closer to our homes. The PowerPod will most likely be available sometime towards the end of 2021. As we can see, wind power generation isn't limited to traditional three-bladed turbines that we're used to seeing everywhere. These innovative, small-scale, lower-maintenance wind generators with no or hidden moving parts hold a lot of promise. In the coming years, we'll probably be seeing more of these alternatives on tops of office buildings and even our homes. I think I'd opt for the PowerPod over a wiggling column, but I won't be too picky. But if you'd like to understand more about how the Vortex Bladeless design even works, or how the ions flow from the solid-state designs that I talked about, you can learn a lot from the electricity and magnetism course at Brilliant. It helped me get a better sense for how everything related to electricity or magnetism starts with a charge, and how ions can flow across different elements like salt water. But even if you don't get charged up about electricity, I love a good dad joke, they have over 60 courses including topics in computer science, physics, and mathematics. They've got something for everybody. All of the concepts are taught through fun and interactive challenges to help you understand the why of something, not just the how. It helps you to develop your intuition, which is my favorite part about Brilliant and taps into the way I learn. Go to brilliant.org/undecided to sign up for free. The first 200 people will get 20% off their annual premium membership. Thanks to Brilliant and to all of you for supporting the channel. So would you want to put something like a PowerPod in your home? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all my patrons, and a big welcome to new producer, Serverless Nomad. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one.